All right. So now we have already installed our Spark in Ubuntu, right? Now, having said that, let's try to get started with the same word count example, which we have done in Windows. As I said, the only difference would be the change of the file. Okay. Now what we will do is, now we will create a file called word1.txt under /homesduser. Okay. Inside your /homesduser, let us create a file called word1.txt. So let's go back. This is your Scala cell, right? So let me open another terminal. Or let me say quit. That's okay. All right. So I'll say vim word1.txt. Okay. Now by default, you don't have anything here, right? So keep pressing DDDD. And this will all be deleted. Escape colon WQ. Done. So there is nothing in this file now. Okay. Press insert and then type your words, whatever you want to. So let me copy this whole word. Paste it. Escape colon WQ. The file is saved. Okay. So if your file is saved, just have a look. cat /home/sd. You don't really have to write this long thing. Just say tilde, because tilde by default means home. All right, this is how it looks like. Okay, this is how it looks like your the content of the file. Done. Now you launch your Spark cell in local mode. So make sure that your Hadoop is up and running, which we already have, right? So you just say JPS, our Hadoop is up and running. Okay. Now you start your Spark cell by either of these two commands. Okay. This time, let me use this. Okay, so your Spark is ready. Okay, now see, it says your Spark UI is available at this particular machine and the port number. So let me copy this and let me go back to Windows. Let's say paste. Okay. So this is what it shows, right? So you are basically accessing that UI. Okay. Now let's move on. So we are in our Scala cell. Okay. This looks a little blur, but this is how it is coming now. Let me increase the font if you need that. So not getting option to increase the font. Is that okay, guys? The fonts are okay. All right. So most of the time I will not be using, this REPL in window in Ubuntu. Okay. So whenever needed, I'll go back to Ubuntu and most probably will do most of the things using IntelliJ. Anyways, now let's try to load the RDD, right? So we have created this word1.txt in this particular file, and they are a part of our local file system. It is not a part of my SDFS, and that's the reason I wrote file colon //. So this will create the RDD from this file, and then if you want to see what is the current output, you say collect. So collect is a transformation or collect is an action. is collect a transformation or is collect an action. So it's basically an action. Why? Because it is bringing the data, right? It is bringing the data for you. Okay. So if it is an action, go back here, say refresh. Okay. So every action is basically a job. So if you see, it got executed for this collect. Okay. It got executed for this collect. Click on this. You get the description. We will explore it more. We'll explore it more. But there is something also called DAG visualization, wherein you can see what happened. Okay. What happened was a text file was there and that text file was collected. That's it. A text file was collected. Okay, let's move on. Now what I'll do is I have my input. From this input, let me do a flat map. We have already learned what exactly it does, right? So for me, now I'll simply be copy pasting it. Copy this and paste it here. So flat map, what do you think about flat map? Is that an action or is that a transformation? Flat map is always a transformation. How can you say that? See, a transformation will always return you back another RDD. Okay, anything which is again returning you back another RDD is 200%, they are all transformations. Done. Now again, let me say what's dot collect. So I'm basically trying to check what is happening after every step. This is how you'll code, right? Because you should know what exactly is happening. Okay, so what I got is words dot collect. When I did, I got everything as a single output, right? So like as an individual elements. Okay, now again, go back here. You go to jobs. Now, if you see, there are two collects. This collect is the recent collect because you have done flat map and then you did a collect, right? So let's click on this. So see this, you had the text file. You did a flat map on it, right? And finally you did a collect. This collect will not be displayed here. Remember one thing, these are all actions. So whenever you see this DAG, in this DAG, you don't get to see these actions. They are not mentioned in your DAG. Because of this, these two things have actually executed. So all your actions would be here. Okay, let's move on. Now, after that, once we get this data, once we get this input.flatmap, what are we going to do next? We are going to emit word comma one for every such words. Done. Again, this is also another transformation. Okay. Again, I'm trying to say collect just to know what exactly will I get now. So if you see, I'll get all these things. Remember, by mistakely there is some empty string over here. By mistakely, it is possible that there was a more than one space, and because of that, one space has come here. So you should basically use a filter to filter this out. But I'm not doing it right now. Okay. So count per word, right? So we have again executed one action. So again, let me go back and say jobs. I got another collect now, right? So this collect is the recent collect which I've done. Click on this. See, text file, flat map, and then map. Text file to load the data into RDD, flat map to divide the data based on space, and then map to transform the data into, like, you know, apple one, ball one, and so on, right? And then finally collect. So remember one thing, all of them are on the same stage. This is very, very important for you to understand. Okay, even expect this kind of questions from the interviewer. Okay, the interviewer may give you some code snippet. Say, he may say, there is a data in a file, and I said sc.txt file, then I said sc.flatmap, then I said sc.map word comma one. Okay, and then finally I say sc.collect. How many stages it will result into? You may say 4 stages, 3 stages. No, that should be only 1 stage. Okay, done. Now let's go back and do a reduce by. Okay, now let's go back and do a reduce by. So reduce by, you can write reduce by key, you can write this way, or you can also write it the way I have shown you, like underscore plus underscore. Okay, so this reduce by key has also given you another RDD, right? So I believe this should also be a transformation. It should not be an action, right? Let me go back. You still have only 3. You did not get another job over here. So they are transformation. And remember one thing, anything which is returning you back in RDD, close your eyes and say it is a transformation. Okay, now again, let me try to say collect count.collect. Okay, also one thing you remember, when I did a reduce by key, what I got is a shuffled RDD. Okay, mind it, I got a shuffled RDD. Okay, now I'm saying counts.collect. So when I do a counts.collect, let's go back and say, click on this. So again, I got a collect, and this is the, this is because of the recent collect, whatever we have done. Let's click on it. Okay. Now, if you see here, you have 2 stages. Here you have 2 stages, right? So this is stage 1 and this is stage 2. Okay. Don't get carried away by this number, stage 3 and stage 4. It is showing you this because, see, let me go here. It started with stage 0. Let me go back here. It is saying it is stage 1. Let me go back here. It is showing me stage 2. Okay. So these numbers are incremented. But if you talk about a single job, then this is basically what? Your 2-stage job. Okay. Wherein stage 1 has got all these things and stage 2 has got this. And why there was another stage? Because there was a shuffle. Think logically, reduce by key. What does it do? Does this collect all the key together? Yes. And assume you have a cluster of, let's say, 10 nodes, wherein each of these nodes is holding one or other word. When you say reduce by key, all those data has to be traveled, right? All those data should travel in one of the node so that they can be grouped together. Because after grouping, that would be processed together, is not it? And that is why there is a shuffle here. Okay, and that is why there is a shuffle here, and because of that, you got another stage. So this is stage 1 and this is stage 2. So I will basically suggest to you guys, whatever experiment you do, whatever, you know, things you are exploring, always go back to your DAG and always see what is the DAG equivalent of these things, and slowly things would be quite clear. And how it will help you is, tomorrow when you are trying to do, tomorrow when you are trying to, you know, like, solve a problem using 2 approaches, execute both the approach, come back to DAG, see where the data shuffling is less. Okay, wherever the data shuffling is less, that is the correct place. That's the basically better approach. So you can go ahead with that solution. Okay, and finally, I would say save as text file. So let me choose some other name. I don't know if the file is already exist. So I'm saying counts.save as text file. It's done. Okay, let's go back to the job. Right. So again, that is also basically an action because it does some operation. It executes all your RDD. Okay. So this is also your action. So click on this. Run job at Hadoop Spark Hadoop writer. Okay. And then if you see here, there is something called blur and there is something called active. I'll talk about this in the future classes. Okay, I'll talk about this in the future classes. All right, so I hope you got the understanding how the data, how the stages are created, what all will be put together in the stages and so on. So given a big steps, go back to your DAG, see, visualize, try to visualize it. In the future chapters, we will explore a lot about this DAG. We'll see when exactly the data is suffering and when exactly the data is not suffering. Okay, so let me tell you, all these steps were skipped in this case. These things were not at all done. Okay, only these steps were done. Only these steps were done. Okay, why, we will explore it later. Let's not worry about it right now. Okay, now what I'll do is, I want to process the data which is present in my SDFS, not in my local file system. Okay, it's very, very simple. So what I'll do is, let me go back to my Ubuntu, and we have a file called word1.txt, is not it? So do you remember, guys, this command? What does it do? What does this command do? This command will put the data from local file system to SDFS, right? It will load the data from local to SDFS. The old command is Hadoop fs-put. Instead of that, you can also use like this SDFS dfs-put, right? So yeah, so let's get this done. So I believe this one file might be already present in my SDFS, and I may get the error like file already exists. Yeah. So let me say, see, the old command is Hadoop fs hyphen rm. I want to delete this file. Deleted, okay? And then I want to put them, right? So say Hadoop fs hyphen put slash, what I want to put in my slash user SD user, sorry, in my home, SD user, I have word1.txt. Okay. Where I want to put? I want to put under slash user SD user as word1.txt. This is the old command. But both of them would work. Okay. Choice is yours, whatever you want to choose. Done. So I've added that file into my word1.txt. Now what we will do is, let's launch our Spark cell again. Spark cell. Okay, so this time, let me say sc.txt file and let me pass the SDFS path like this. Okay, now let me just say input.collect. Okay, so see, I'm able to get this data, which means I'm actually getting the data from SDFS, right? So that's how you will basically read the data from SDFS. Okay, and then the other steps would remain same as it is. Once you have the data in your SDFS, let's try something like this as well. So let me say, I'll write here SDFS colon slash slash localhost colon 9000 slash user slash SD user 1.txt. And again, let's say input.collect. Unknown local host, spelling mistake. Okay. Okay. So you say input.collect and the data is available. So see, the best way to confirm would be use a full path and you'll be 200% sure. Okay, now Hadoop, when you start Hadoop, sorry, when you start Spark, okay, by default, it is pointing to SDFS. So by default, when you specify this path, it is pointed to SDFS. And that is the reason when I was trying to read the data, see, when I was trying to read the data from a local file, why did I write file colon slash slash? It is because I wanted to tell Hadoop that Spark that, hey, don't look into SDFS by default. Okay, I'm giving you path file. That means you should go and check the local file path. Okay, so let me put a point over here. You can also specify fully qualified SDFS path as shown below. Let me not write this. So this would help you, right? So if you want to give a fully qualified class path, then you can give the fully qualified path. Okay. This will help you to understand that, yes, I'm actually reading the data from SDFS. This might confuse you still. If you give any path like this, then it will always consider this to be a SDFS path, not a local path. If you want to tell explicitly that I am looking for the file in the local path, then you should write like this. However, if you want to clearly say that, hey, it is SDFS, so you can also do it this way.